Good morning to all. This is the fourth day of the FDP. Today our chief guest is Dr. K. Chandrasekhar sir, professor of mechanical engineering and also principal Vignan Institute of Management and Technology for Women, Hyderabad. Now I call our principal to deliver the welcome address.
Namaskaram and good morning to all of you.
Good morning.
On behalf of our management, I heartily welcome the chief guest of today's webinar, Dr. K. Chandrasekhar sir. He is a professor of mechanical engineering. Also, he is working as a principal. Vignan Institute of Management and Technology for Women, Hyderabad, Telangana. He is going to discuss the topic fracture toughness evaluation. Regarding our chief guest, I like to give a few information about him. He completed his B.Tech Mechanical Engineering from Kakadia Institute of Technology and Science, Warangal, in the year 1998. Then he completed his M.Tech Industrial Metallurgy from NIT, Warangal, in the year 2000. Then he completed PhD from JNTU, Hyderabad, in the year 2016. His thesis title is Strengthening in and Fracture Behavior of CNT and Carbon Fiber Reinforced Epoxic Matrix Hybrid Composite Material. He is having very rich experience, professional experience. He served as assistant professor to professor. Now he is becoming as principal. He's having more than 20 years of experience in teaching field. His research interests are characterization of composite materials, machinability studies of various materials, weldability studies of various materials. He's having very good publications in international journals, approximately 38. And also in conferences, approximately 26. He has wrote a lot of monographs, textbooks, and book chapters, nearly 8. Also, he received a few prestigious honors and awards, like Bharat Jyoti Award from Dr. Bhishma Narayan Singh, former governor of Tamil Nadu and Assam. In the year 2017. Also, he received a Research Excellence Award in the year 2018 for his paper publication in Springer by Institute of Exploring Advances in Engineering, Karnataka. Also, he received Best Paper Award from Madras Institute of Technology campus, Anna University, Chennai, in the year 2017 for his technical paper on effect of 0.5 weight percentage AM and WCNTS addition on the fracture behavior of epoxy and epoxy carbon fiber reinforced composites. Also, he is having membership in a few professional organizations like Institute of Engineers, IST, then Society of Failure Analysis, and then this SCE, India Southern Region Section, then International Association of Engineers, and Institute of Research Engineers and Doctors. So he's having very good research and academic experience. He's a very good speaker in this fracture toughness evaluation topic. He's going to share his knowledge and experience with our participants. So, with this, I request the chief guest to have his platform to sharing his ideas and experience. I request the all the participants to post your queries in the chat box and keenly observe what are the information and points shared by our chief guest. They will be very useful for your research and expand your knowledge in this field. So now I hand over the session to our chief guest, Dr. K. Chandrasekhar sir, to share his views and information on the fracture toughness evaluation. Sir, please take the platform, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a nice introduction. So first, I thanks to management of EGS Pillai Engineering College. So principal of EGS Pillai College and coordinators, HOD of mechanical department and Chokalingam sir, for his continuous touch with me. So regarding this, am I audible to all? Chokalingam sir?
Audible, sir.
Hello?
It's audible, sir. Audible, sir.
Shall I continue now?
Yes, right, sir. Right. Go ahead, sir.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. So good morning to all participants and team of EGS Pillai Engineering College. Today's my topic of presentation is fracture toughness evaluation, a case study of polymer matrix composites. So I'll go to the next slide. Right. So before going to the contents of this particular presentation, just I'll discuss about this particular slide. Next, I'll go to the contents of this today's presentation. So in the olden days, so we have some materials. So based on the application, so we have to choose the material. That means some specific materials were available in the olden days. So based on the application, so we have to choose the material. So nowadays, so due to the revolution in the material science, now, so based on the application, so we are creating the materials. So that is creation of materials. So we know the materials are classified into broadly three categories. So metals, ceramics, and polymers. So you know about the metals. So widely used among all the categories are metals. But the main problem with the metals, so metals are having low strength to weight ratio. Low strength to weight ratio means weight is high, strength is low. That is the reason. So the strength to weight ratio is decreasing. So that is the reason. So in most of the case, in aerospace sectors, so metals are replaced by some other materials. So those materials are composites. Suppose if you see this air, I'll go to next one. Afterwards, I'll discuss what is. So next material is ceramics. So ceramics having very high temperature resistance, but that is the major limitation of the ceramics is brittle one. And coming to the polymers, so they are temperature sensitive. We cannot use these polymers, so above 250 degrees centigrade. That and so with this, with the revolution of material science and engineering, so now we are enjoying the advances in materials. That is, composite materials came into the world, and we have semiconductors, so which are widely used in electronic industry. So the right side diagram also we can see. So traditional materials, now we have engineering materials. So we can tailor the performance of materials. That means, so regarding, suppose some strength is required for me, some hardness is required for me. So based on our requirement, so we can increase the properties and using the design of materials. In the design of materials, process control and microstructure control plays a key role. Now finally, we are going to get the desired performance. So here, so metal, ceramics, polymers are having their own limitations. So due to the revolution in the material science and technology, material science and engineering, now we have composite materials, so which is having very high strength to weight ratio. Now, before going to my exact topic, so I've divided my scheme of my today's presentation into three parts. In the first part, I'm going to explain about the introduction to composites. In the second part, I'm going to explain about the, I will introduce some fracture toughness parameters. And in the third part, I'm going to discuss about the case study. So I'm going to take this is, so PMCs, polymer matrix composites. Let us come to the part one. Now let us see, it's my duty to tell the definition also. Most of the people know about the definition, but some things may be missing. So composite material, the basic definition of composite material is, so composite material is a judicious combination of two or more differently distinct diffases combined on the micro, macro, or nano scale are called composites. So here, in simple words, So composite is a combination of two or more different phases. So here we should be very clear about, so what is the difference between the alloy and composite? So we have same definition for alloy also. It's a mixture of at least two elements. So here also we are saying, so material is, composite material is a combination of two elements. That is a judicious combination. Anyway, that is also a judicious combination. But here, if we see this, so here, before going to the why composites are important, now let us clearly see, so what is the difference between the alloy and composite? An alloy is a mixture of at least two elements, with one of those elements being a metal. Alloy can come both in solid or solution forms. For example, alloy, you can take steel. So steel means it's a combination of iron and carbon. The steel properties are very higher as compared to the pure iron. So similarly, the one more example for the alloy is brass. It is a mixture of copper and zinc. So the basic, if you see the basic definition of the alloy, it is at least of two elements. One of the element is being metal. So if you see them composite, if we see the composite definition, composite is much like an alloy, a combination of at least two or more components. However, why an alloy must, alloy contains a metal in it. A composite does not have any metal included in its mixture. The composite, the components of a composite are always chemically and physically different from one another. And these materials are commonly called constituent materials. In the composite, two materials are called constituent materials. However, so despite the interaction between the two constituent materials, so they play separate within the finished mixture because of their chemical and physical differences. And one more basic difference between the alloy and the composite is, alloy can be either homogeneous or heterogeneous mixtures, while the composite are always heterogeneous and will never form homogeneous mixture. And this is about the, this is a major difference between the composite and alloy. Now let us see why composites are important. So as I discussed in the classification of the materials in the previous slide, composites are very strong and stiff and light in weight. So the ratios of strength to weight ratio and strength to stiffness to weight ratio are several times greater than steel. So it is almost 10 times greater than the steel. And if you see the properties of steel, so we know the tensile strength of steel is 400 MPa. But if you see the one constituent of composite material, the carbon is 5,650 MPa. We can see only 420 MPa is steel strength and 5,600 is MPa steel strength, carbon fiber strength. That means how many times we can see, almost 10 to 12 times greater strength for one constituent only. So if you see the Young's modulus also, Young's modulus of steel is very well known one, that is 200 GPa. So if you see the carbon, one of the fiber, one type of fiber, so that Young's modulus is 531 MPa. And now people are using nanotubes, and it is very much far away from this strength value. That means tensile strength is some 100 GPa, 100 to 200 GPa. Young's modulus is 1 to 2 terapascals, that is 10 to the power of 12. That is, so these composites are having very, very high strength as compared to steel and aluminium and any metallic materials. So why steel and aluminium? Steel and aluminium are widely used in aerospace materials. That is the reason here I have taken the steel and aluminium. And now you can see here, because of this high strength to weight ratio, so we are using this in aerospace sector. Now if you see the Boeing 787 aircraft, so is made up of 80% of composite by volume. 80%, that is previously metallic material replaced by composites, that is 80% by volume. And by weight, the material contents is 50% composite and 20% aluminium, 15% titanium, 10% steel, and 5% other. That means if you see the volume percentage, that is 80% of the volume percentage replaced with composites and 50% weight percentage replaced with composites. So the only one reason why metallic materials are replaced with composites is its strength to weight ratio and stiffness to weight ratio is very much greater as compared to metallic materials. Second one is fatigue properties are generally better than the common engineering materials, and toughness is greater, and composites that do not corrode like steel, there is no question of corrosion in the composite materials, and possible to achieve the properties that is not attainable with metal, ceramics, polymers alone. So this is a very important characteristic of composite materials. Now I discussed in the basic definition of composite, Composite is a combination of two constituent. One is called fiber, the second one is called matrix. So the matrix, the purpose of the matrix is it holds the fibers together and it distributes the load to the fibers. So whereas the purpose of the fiber is it bears the load. And so suppose in the general, the basic example, we can take the slab. Slab is the in slab we have concrete. So in between the concrete, we'll place the steel rods. The steel rods purpose is it bears the load. The purpose of the concrete is it distributes the load to the steel rods and And suppose here multi-store building, three-store, four-store, five-store like that. That means the size of the rod increases. That means here the load bearing capacity has to increase. That is the reason fiber plays a major role to bear the load. Now you can see the fiber properties. The stress value is more and strength value is, strain value is very less. So whereas the matrix, you can see the stress is very low and strength is strain is very high. So here,
tell me. I'm not at sound is there.
Sound from my side, no sound, sir.
Okay, sir.
Yes, hello.
Okay,
sir. No one is there. My room. This is a closed room. No one is there.
The mic sound is some echo is there.
I don't know, sir. I'll reduce my volume otherwise.
Okay, sir.
So composite is having the optimum. Now it's okay. Shukran, sir.
Unless a little bit sound is key.
Now.
Okay, sir.
Now the composite properties are in between the fiber and the matrix. So here. Now based on the matrix material, the composite materials are classified into three categories: metal matrix composites, polymer matrix composites, ceramic matrix composites. Now if we see here, metal matrix composite characteristics are enhanced modulus with or without enhanced strength, enhanced wear and erosion resistance, adequate fracture resistance. These are the advantages of metal matrix composites. Coming to the limitations of the metal matrix composites, fabricability is somewhat difficult, and joining technology is also difficult, and designing is complex. We cannot do NDT that much easily, and these are expensive. Coming to the polymer matrix composites, which are widely used for structural applications, enhanced strength and modulus, enhanced fracture resistance, and low strength and service temperatures. That means we cannot use this polymer matrix composites above 200 degrees or 250 degrees centigrade. NDT is also difficult. They're all expensive. And coming to the ceramic matrix composites, the outstanding property is, so it can, we can use at ultra high temperatures, and composite is only making ceramics amenable for structural applications. And the disadvantages are the fracture toughness is very low, NDT we can difficult, designing also complex, and large scatter in the mechanical properties, the major limitation of most of the composite materials, not only ceramic matrix. So that is, the properties are anisotropic, and these ceramic matrix also expensive. Among all these, the common disadvantage or common limitation for all the composites is, so here NDT testing is difficult and these are expensive, and the properties are anisotropic in nature. So coming to the strength fracture toughness combinations, so some blue color, some rectangular box is there. So that is, in that box, totally composites are there. Engineering polymers are there, engineering ceramics are. So if you clearly see this particular diagram, so these are having high strength values, but the fracture toughness, on y-axis, we have fracture toughness. The fracture toughness values are comparably, relatively low as compared to the engineering alloys. Now, the strength is low, but strength is high, but fracture toughness is low. That is the reason the worldwide, the research is going on to increase the fracture toughness of these composite materials. So by using suitable design methodologies. So coming to the composite, so it's a combination of fiber and matrix material. In the fiber, there are different types of fibers. So in the left side graph, so I'm saying specific strength versus modulus. So we have various types of fibers are available in the market. S-glass, E-glass, steel wire, beryllium, aluminium, graphite, carbon. So among all the fibers, so here carbon fibers are having high specific strength and specific modulus. So if it combines with the matrix material, the right side is here, the left side one is only matrix, sorry, only fiber properties. The right side one is the combination of matrix and fiber properties. So if the fiber is combined with the matrix, so automatically the strength and all the other values are decreases to some extent. So that is very clearly shown in the right side diagram. So we have in the previous one, we have seen the composite classification. So based on the matrix, ceramic matrix, polymer matrix, and metal matrix composites. So here we have different types of fibers. So based on the, so fibers are, it may be particulates, it may be platelets, it may be continuous fibers, it may be discontinuous fibers, it may be short fibers, it may be long fibers. It in the, again, in the weaving technology, so we can use 1D, 2D, 3D, 2.5D, like this. So based on the design, based on the required properties, so we can tailor the properties. And this is also same slide. So here, so based on the orientation, based on the stacking sequence, suppose this particular style is it's a continuous fibers. In the top one, it is written as 0 degrees, next 90 degrees, plus 45, minus 45, like this. So 0 degrees means, so let us say all are in the vertical one. From our direction is a vertical one. So this is called unidirectional composite. If it is only, if all the fibers, so one is called laminae, one is called lamina. Suppose if you take one book, each paper is called one lamina. So if you combine all the papers, it is called laminate. So each paper is, here it is called one composite lamina. So if you combine all the composite laminas, it is called as laminates. Suppose if you first layer of the composite, so is with 0 degrees, next is 90 degrees, next is plus 45. That is fiber orientation. Next is minus 45. If you align like that, so we can get the required properties. That this stacking sequence, so we have to choose based on the required properties. Now, if you see, one of my MTech students did this work. You can see here, first one is, so to prepare one composite, so we have selected 24 plies. So 24 plies, we have taken only 0 degrees. So that is called unidirectional composite. So in that, we got the value EX equal to 137.8 GPA, EY is 11.7. So you can see the remaining all the values that in the remaining one, that is 1644 means 16 plies with 0 degrees, 4 is with plus 45, 4 is minus 45. That means among all, so we can observe here, so unidirectional composite that gives maximum strength as compared to the other one. But the major problem with the unidirectional composite is, so we can get the maximum value only in the longitudinal direction. The load application must be in the longitudinal direction. You can see here, EY value for other for all other composites is gradually increasing, but EX value is decreasing. That means here the composites are directionality in nature. So this is also same 2D, 3D fibers, right? So coming to the advantages of composites, so the composites having low density and high compressive strength and high temperatures, especially CMCs. So basically CMCs are so very good compressive strength and very low tensile strengths. High range of electrical and thermal resistivity, which can be altered suitably. Enhanced wear and erosion resistance. Enhanced fracture reference compared to their constituents. So some specific properties, optical, physical property, or electromagnetic property, these are the basic advantages of composites. Coming to the limitations of the composites, high flaw density, large variation in flaw distribution, especially in CMCs. Low tensile strength, either in PMCs or in CMCs. Large scatter in the strength value. That is the reason I told you in the beginning. So these are having anisotropy properties. If you want to use the composite in a service application, so we have to use in only one particular direction. Suppose if you take any metallic material, you can keep in any direction, but that is not the case with composite. Only in the particular, because based on the load direction, so we have to use these composites. So these are extremely sensitive to the biaxial stresses or transfer tensile stresses. So they are susceptible to subcritical crack growth, difficult design and inspection methodologies, and high cost. So these are the limitations of the composites. And fabrication also somewhat difficult in the composites. And now, I told you in the beginning, so these we have seen the diagram, the refractive toughness one strength diagram. So in the diagram clearly we have seen composite is having high strength but low fracture toughness value. High strength to weight ratio as compared to metals. But the only problem is low fracture toughness. So here we have to improve the fracture toughness. So by using fiber toughening. So that mechanism is called crack bridging. So we can quantify these parameters. So by using the well-known parameter is known as total fracture energy release rate. So which is denoted better J suffix C. Now how to enhance so the fracture toughness or energy. If we see this, so one effect is called bridging effect. I'm going to explain clearly in the next slides what is the bridging effect, how it affects. So the first one is called crack path meandering, that is deflection path. So instead of a single crack, so if the particular cracks take a new path, or that the crack is divided into new other number of cracks, that is branch wise cracks, that means it requires more fracture energy. Automatically the fracture resistance of the material increases. So similarly, the bridging effect is generally due to the debonding and pull out of fracture of fibers. So you can see right side that the diagram versus fracture resistance versus crack extension. In the first one, so we can see the fracture resistance is constant for the brittle materials. So after some crack extension, the material is going to fail. So whereas in the case of the tough material, so we can see the raising R curve. The raising R curve means the fracture resistance gradually increases, so with the extension of the crack. So this is the important property in the tough material, that means so this is amenable for toughening. So we have two approaches in the fracture mechanics. The first one is called LEFM approach, that is called linear elastic fracture mechanics approach. And second one is in the plastic region. So we have to use the approach is known called as elastic plastic fracture mechanics approach. So here this regarding this, so we are going to see in the next slides. I told you in the crack bridging. So the crack bridging is generally due to the debonding of matrix or pull out of the fibers. So you can see here, the pull out that causes frictional dissipation of energy. So that is due to the acoustic waves. Here pull out of the fibers. So this acts like a bridge between the cracked surface. So again to break that, so more amount of fracture is required so that the fracture toughness increases. It's like a bridge. So we have some here in the part two of my presentation. I'm going to introduce some fracture toughness parameters. So one fracture toughness parameter is called K1C, so which is called as plane strain fracture toughness. So this plane strain fracture toughness, so we are going to use in LEFM, that is linear elastic fracture mechanics approach. So whereas in the case of EPFM, elastic plastic fracture mechanics approach, so we are going to use the word JC, so which is nothing but total fracture energy release rate. So based on these values, so we can able to say whether the material fracture resistance is high or low or adequate, right? So there are three ways of applying a force. Always if we apply the force on a material, then only the material is going to fail. So what type of loading, what type of force we are applying, that is very important. Direction of the force is very important, especially in the composites. So we have three ways of applying force. The first one is called opening mode, or is also called as tensile mode. The second one is called shear mode, which is also called as mode 2 or in plane shear. The third one is called tear mode, which is called as out of plane shear or mode 3. The material may be subjected to only mode 1 or only mode 2 or only mode 3, or it is a combination of mode 1 and mode 2, mode 1 and mode 3, and mode 2 and mode 3, like that. Any combination is possible. So that is based on the service applications. Now, so we have different parameters, fracture toughness in a fracture mechanics approach. So I have discussed this in the previous slide. So we have some new terms are there here. So plane strain fracture toughness, so which is K1C, and plane strain is denoted by letter KC. Elastic fracture toughness is known as J1C. So one thing we have to remember here, the lattice K that comes only in the linear elastic fracture mechanics. The lattice with G, J with some suffix that are going to come in the elastic plastic fracture mechanics. K only in the linear region, so linear elastic fracture mechanics, so J in the case of elastic fracture mechanics. So actually the first JC approach first introduced in 1960s in case of concrete materials and adopted very effectively for composites since 1980s. And this provides excellent explanations for quantification of toughening in bridging. So this is a measure of general fracture toughness encompassing different modes of loading. Right. Now in this presentation, I emphasized basically my title also fracture toughness evaluation. So generally everyone knows about the tensile testing, compressive testing. So tensile testing means we have to pull that, and generally dog bone specimen is used. In fiber reinforced composites, generally instead of dog bone specimen, we'll use the rectangular specimen only, because so that the edges, if the sharp corners are there, so that leads to fiber pull out and fiber debonding. So that is the reason here that acts as stress concentrations, the material is going to fail. That is the reason most of the composite testing in the tensile one, so we'll use the rectangular specimens. Anyway, my emphasis, I'm going to discuss about the fracture toughness one. So various samples are available, various samples we can use as per the ASTM standards. So here ASTM standard for composites is, for fracture toughness evaluation is, especially polymer composites is ASTM standard D5045. So one of the simple specimen preparation is SCNB specimen. Single edge notch bend specimens or notch beam specimens are used. So we have to prepare the specimens as per the ASTM standards. So after preparing the specimens as per the ASTM standards, the next very important in the fracture toughness evaluation is we have to introduce the crack. So how to introduce the crack? So we have to introduce the crack so by means of diamond wafer cutting blades or simple razor blades. So if we use the diamond wafer cutting blades, so we are going to get very thin. So suppose here in the right side diagram, you can see here I have introduced one crack. So if you draw one particular circle inside this crack, so if you measure the radius, so that radius is called notch root radius. So preferably the notch root radius must be very low. Suppose here, if the notch root radius increases, the fracture toughness also abnormally increases. There is no valid, we are not going to get the valid fracture toughness. That is the reason I'm going to explain about this also. So what must be the thickness of the notch root radius? What must be the value of the notch root radius? I'm going to explain in the next slides. The first one is here, after taking the SCNB specimen, that is single edge notch bend, that is nothing but rectangular specimen of some dimensions according to ASTM. Next, we have to introduce a crack by using very thin blades. So people are using simple razor blades also. We're not going to get the exact one. And so these specimens are subjected to 3 or 4 point bend test, simple flexural loading, and we have to use the control testing ramp rate, cross slide speed according to the ASTM standards. And next. And the same SCNB specimens, we can calculate the LEFM parameters or we can calculate the EPFM parameters also. So here to calculate the EPFM parameters, that is JC or J1C, simply JC means total fracture energy release rate. So J1C means at peak load, we have to take the fracture energy release rate, that is called J1C. So I think you got the meaning of JC and J1C. So JC is nothing but fracture energy release rate for the entire fracture process. So comprising the various mechanisms. So J1C means at maximum load, what is the fracture energy release rate? That is nothing but J1C. So to calculate JC value, so we have to draw different displacement, that is delta 1, delta 2, delta 3 is there, which encompasses all the fracture events. Suppose you can take delta 1. Delta 1 I have taken at the elastic region. So delta 2 I have taken at the maximum peak load. delta 3 I have taken in the plastic region like this. So I have to, we have to decide various displacements. After taking the various displacement, so we have to calculate the fracture energy release rate below this curve, and we have to substitute in the formulas. So JC is equal to delta EFR divided by delta A, so A difference of A, so divided by B. We can substitute, we'll get the answer. Now, so to calculate K1C, so that previous one is to calculate the EPFM parameters, one is called JC. That is total, if you take the total entire area under the curve, so that is going to give the JC value. So if you take the only up to maximum load, that is going to give the value J1C value. Similarly, to calculate the values in the linear elastic fracture mechanism, that is a linear region. So here this, only for all the things, only one test is required. That is nothing but 3-point bend test or 4-point bend test. 3-point bend test is quite easy as compared to 4-point bend test. So here, before going to the calculation of linear elastic fracture mechanics approach parameters, so we have to draw, anyway, these are computer generated curves in most of the UTMs nowadays are having computer attached one. So this is, there a possibility of type 1 curve or type 2 curve or type 3 curve, that is load displacement curves. On these curves, we have to note down the values of PQ, that is nothing but conditional loads. So this one is P max load. Whatever the thick line is there, so this is already, this is directly we got from the UTM machine. So the thin line is there, this thin line is nothing but 5% secant line we have to draw. So where this 5% secant line is going to intersect with this one, so that is nothing but PQ. So here similarly, so we have to draw all the, we have to calculate the, we have to identify the values of Pmax values and PQ values. And so these, all the conditions must be satisfied. So where B is the width of the sample, and A is the crack length, KQ is the conditional fracture toughness, so this yield strength, all the values must be satisfied. Then only the fracture toughness, whatever the fracture toughness we are going to calculate, that is valid fracture toughness. Otherwise, the fracture toughness is not the valid, invalid fracture toughness. So here you can see here, after calculate the calculation of PQ value, that is conditional load, and we know the span length, so we know the specimen thickness and the width, and we have to substitute in this formula. So finally, we are going to get K1Q. You may have doubt here. So in the top of the one, I shown is K1C, but here it is K1Q is there. So what is the meaning of K1Q? K1Q means conditional fracture toughness. So when this becomes K1C, so in the previous slide, so I shown so three additional criteria here. So if all these criteria are satisfied, then only K1Q becomes K1C. So K1Q, we have to calculate the values. If all the conditions are satisfied, so this conditional fracture toughness, it becomes plane strain fracture toughness, or in simple words, valid fracture toughness. So similarly, so JQK, where Q is coming, that is nothing but apparent or conditional fracture toughness. Here, conditional fracture energy in the case of J. Now, so this is the, in the second part, in the first part, I gave the definitions of the basic composite, and I explained what is the difference between the alloy and the composite, and the composite classification based on the matrix materials and the fiber materials. In the second part, I introduced some of the fracture toughness parameters. Those are K1C, J1C, and JC, and K1Q. So now we'll take these all, whatever we have discussed, once again, we are going to discuss by taking a case study. So that is one polymer matrix composites. Right. So before going to the fracture toughness evaluation of this polymer matrix composites, so polymer matrix composites are widely used in structural applications, so ranging from commercial aircraft to bathtubs. So just in the introduction, I told you very clearly, so Boeing 787 aircraft is 80% composite by volume. That means, so previously aluminium, titanium, steel were used. So completely 80%, most of the parts are replaced with composite because of high strength to weight ratio. So here several applications are given in this slide. I don't want to go into detail. Right. Now in this particular case study, So as we discussed in the previous one, composite is a combination of two or more materials. So one is called fiber material, the second one is called matrix material. So in this particular case study, that is in this polymer matrix composites, I have used two types of reinforcements or fibers. So one type of reinforcement is CNTs. I will discuss about what is AMW. CNTs means carbon nanotubes, so which were processed by plasma CVD process. So AMW means MW stands for multi-walled carbon nanotubes. Multi-walled carbon nanotubes. A stands for amino functionalized multi-walled carbon nanotubes. Amino functionalized. A stands for amino functionalized, and MW stands for multi-walled. Anyway, CNT is known one, carbon nanotubes. So this is one of the reinforcement in my study. So why multifunctionalized, that I will discuss. The second one is called carbon fibers. In this study, I have used T700 carbon fibers. Anyway, widely used epoxies, DGEBA based epoxy resin, diglycerol ether of bisphenol A epoxy resin I have used in my study. And coming to the proportions, I use epoxy resin and only 0.5 fixed percentage. In this, I'm going to present only one case, that is 0.5 weight percentage of amino multi-wall carbon nanotubes. So which are having dimensions 20 to 30 nanometers and length 2 to 4 microns, length in terms of microns and diameter in terms of nanometers. And that is nothing but nanotubes. Second one, anyway, hardener for curing purpose. I used here DETDA hardener, which is quite common hardener, and epoxy material, also DGBA based epoxy material. So here two types of fibers we have used, reinforcement. One is carbon fibers, the second one is CNTs. Coming to next one. So basically the epoxy resin is having high strength, low viscosity, high chemical and corrosion resistance, high adhesion and dimensional stability, density is 1.16 grams per cc. So the basic advantage of composites is low density, whereas if you see the metallic materials, 7.9 or 7.8, around 8 grams per cc. So whereas composites is around 1 to 2, in between 1 to 2 grams per cc. Young's modulus is pi, that is 3.414 GPA. So most of the polymer matrix composites in structural applications, invariably epoxy resin is used as a matrix. Coming to the one reinforced material is amino functionalized multi-walled carbon nanotubes. So here basically carbon nanotube is having diameter in the nanometers and length in the microns. And I used here multi-wall carbon nanotube. There are so many types of nanotubes are available in the market. Single wall carbon nanotubes, double wall carbon nanotubes, multi-wall carbon nanotubes. So whereas single wall carbon nanotubes are having high surface area, strength is also very, very high as compared to multi-wall carbon nanotubes. But why we are using multi-wall carbon nanotubes is the more agglomeration and it settles at one place. That is the main problem with the single wall carbon nanotubes. So they are very expensive and mixing also somewhat difficult in the case of single wall carbon nanotubes as compared to the multi-wall carbon nanotubes. So that is the reason multi-wall carbon nanotubes are widely used as compared to single wall and double wall carbon nanotubes. The second one is why functionalization is required. This is a basic question. Suppose if you didn't use any, if I use multi-wall carbon nanotubes in my study or any study, what happens is there is a much possibilities of agglomeration. So agglomeration is nothing but it settles at one place. It won't distribute into homogeneously throughout the material. That is called agglomeration. So what we are going to do with this functionalization means, so we are going to create the same charge for all carbon nanotubes. That means same charge means it repels with each other. Automatically, the homogeneous distribution takes place inside the matrix material. That is the reason. So only the purpose of functionalization is, there are so many functionalization methods are there. The basic use or purpose of the functionalization is, so the carbon nanotubes should be uniformly distributed throughout the matrix material. That is the reason one of the functionalization is amino functionalization In my study, I have used these amino-functionalized multi-walled carbon nanotubes. So these are having Young's modulus around 1.8 TPA, and density is 1.33 grams per cc. And anyway, so these are having very extraordinary mechanical properties and toughest materials on the earth, carbon nanotubes, and unique atomic structure and high aspect ratio because of surface area only, because of large surface area alone, we are getting this much properties. And next. So in this particular study, I prepared three types of materials. The first one is nanocomposites. Nanocomposites means only multi-walled carbon nanotubes are introduced into the epoxy material. The second one is neat epoxy. Neat epoxy means, so not added any type of fiber reinforcements. Only that is only matrix material, that is called neat epoxy, because I want to find out the effect of reinforcement. The third material I prepared, hybrid one. That is, I introduced both nanomaterial and carbon fibers into the matrix. So let us come to the first, nanocomposite. Here the main problem with the nanocomposite is dispersion of multi-walled carbon nanotubes into the matrix. So this I was ensured by sonication with a probe type sonicator for 45 minutes followed by ball milling for 180 minutes at 250 RPM. So to realize the nanocomposites, I followed some heat treatment cycle, 2 hours for 120 degrees, 3 hours for 180 degrees, which is a peak temperature of the composition under study. Simply neat epoxy. Neat epoxy means without any reinforcements. Was fabricated simply by mixing the curing agent, that is DETDA curing agent, and followed the same heat treatment cycle as for the nanocomposites. Third one is I have prepared the hybrid composite. That means hybrid composite means when hybrid composite, that means the composite is reinforced with two or more reinforcement, that is called hybrid composite. Here composite is mixed with nanotubes as well as carbon fibers. That is reason here I'm calling it as a hybrid composite. More than one reinforcement, that is called hybrid composite. So here in the processing of the hybrid composite, I use same ball milling process. And in my study, all the fibers are only in one direction, that is unidirectional one. And we have done the curing, post-curing, and finally we got the fabrication. So here you can see hybrid composite. I used amino multi-wall carbon nanotubes, so mixed with epoxy resin, so combined with carbon fibers. Finally, I got 3.4 mm thickness laminates, so which is composed of 24 layers. So why 3.4 mm only have taken means to meet the plane strain conditions. Previously we have seen 2.5 into something, K cube by A to the power of whole square, like that we have seen the three conditions in the plane strain condition. We have to satisfy those conditions. To satisfy those conditions, we have to select the proper thickness here. So here to satisfy all those conditions are called plane strain conditions. To satisfy those plane strain conditions, I have taken 3.4 mm thickness. Here I followed the heat treatment cycle. So this is a three-step heat treatment cycle, that is 65 degrees temperature for 0.75 hours, 110 degrees for 2 hours, 160 for 3 hours, and the post-curing, 3 hours for 180 degrees centigrade. So here, if you go directly for 160 degrees for 3 hours, the burning of composite takes place. That is the reason here, gradually, so we have to go for the higher temperatures. Even after the three heat treatment cycles, so I didn't observe any misalignment or I found the same orientation of the carbon fibers. So the second diagram, you can say this diagram here. So there was no disturbance in the orientation of the fibers. So here I measured the carbon fiber diameter. It is 6 microns. You can compare this 6 micron size with our hair size. So generally our hair diameter is ranges from 17 to 180 microns. So as the age grows, generally the hair diameter increases. Average thickness of the hair is 50 to 60 microns. That means, so this carbon fiber, just again giving example to imagine, so what is the thickness of the carbon fiber? What is the diameter of the carbon fiber? So the carbon fiber diameter is nearly 10 times lesser than the hair diameter, that is 6 microns. So whereas hair diameter is average size is 60 microns. Here, so what I mean to say from this diagram is the carbon fibers are having 6 microns in size, and even after three heat treatment cycle, there was no disturbance found in the alignment or orientation of the fibers. Next. I calculated the density and hardness values, and density values for hybrid composite. So some 30% increase in density as compared to nano composite, but hardness value is more than double, that is 65 VHN value as compared to 28 in the nano composite value. So we can see in the significant increase in the hardness value as compared to the nano composite, that is in the hybrid composite value. Next, coming to the, before going to the fracture toughness, the flexural strength value is also required. So flexural strength is simple bending test. So which is we carried out according to the ASTM standard D790. I also conducted interlamellar shear strength. So according to the ASTM standard D2344, and these tests were conducted using Instan UTM. Tests were conducted under 3-point bend loading. So both are using three, that is interlamellar shear strength is abbreviated as ILSS, and flexural properties. Flexural and ILSS both are calculated by using 3-point bending loading only. But the basic difference here, you may ask me, what is the difference between the difference between the flexural testing and interlamellar shear strength? Only that basic difference is the span length. So in the case of the flexural properties, so generally we'll take the span length is 16 times of the thickness. Span length is nothing but the distance between the two supporting pins. So whereas in the case of the interlamellar shear strength, so we'll take the span length is six times the thickness. That means as the span length decreases, it produces shear. As the span length increases, it produces bending. That is, so we have to, very minimum shear is there, so that we have to neglect it. So here, first I have taken the flexural strength of neat epoxy. So here you can see similar to the brittle nature. So I got the value of 100 MPa. So I've taken the minimum 5 samples in all the cases. And if you see the flexural strength value of the nano composite, this is 125 MPb. That is 25% increase in strength as compared to neat epoxy. So you can see here the previous graph and this graph. Here we can see here one stable graph is there. Previously, it ended here only. That is catastrophic failure in the case of the catastrophic failure in the case of neat epoxy. So in the bit here, it is the case of a stable crack. That means this particular part very clearly indicates it is amenable for toughening here. So as the force increases here, so displacement gradually increases. That is the reason here it shows 25% increase in the strength for nano composite as compared to neat composite. So neat epoxy, sorry. So same thing I have shown in the graph. Similarly, you can see for the hybrid, here I'm comparing the flexural strength value for three composites. So here I've got the value 1084 MPa. So which is the hybrid composite in longitudinal direction, that is the crack propagation is perpendicular to the orientation of the fibers. That means some obstacle is there to propagate the crack here. So that is nothing but 1084 MPa. The second, you can see same hybrid composite in the transverse direction, I got very low value. Even this value is very much lesser than the neat epoxy and nano composite. So this is only 38 MPa. So this is very, that means here, there is no contribution of the fibers in this case, because the crack propagation is parallel to the orientation of the fibers. That is, matrix plays a major role here. So there is no resistance to propagation of the crack in this case. That is the reason. So this 38 MPa is very much lower as compared to the longitudinal orientation. So here you can see here that is only 38 MPa. The same here, if you see the graph of longitudinal, and here you can see here the axis, here I have taken on the y-axis load versus displacement here. So here also load versus displacement. The first graph is load versus displacement for longitudinal orientation. You can see the scale on the load axis here around 1500 newtons. So here you can see in the transverse direction, the load is only 60. You can see here, where is 1800, where is 60. That means here matrix plays a major role. Here, fibers plays a major role here. In the longitudinal orientation, fiber plays a major role. In the transverse direction, so there is no contribution of the fibers. Here the crack initiates, it propagates, there is no resistance propagation. That is the reason here we got very low values in the case of the transverse orientation. That means, so we have to use these particular composites only in one particular direction. That is the major disadvantage of these composites. Next one, you can see here, all the values are summarized in one bar graph, 100 MPa, 125 MPa, and 1084 MPa. So 25% is improvement for nano composites, and almost 10 to 12 times greater flexural strength in the case of the CNT and carbon fiber reinforced epoxy composite, or simply it is called as a hybrid composite. Now, secondly, I calculated ILSS properties for hybrid composites. And one thing I have to mention very clearly here, interlamellar shear strength properties are applicable only for the fiber reinforced composites. First, I prepared three types of composite. First one, neat epoxy, nano composite. So there are no fiber particles there. In the first one, neat epoxy means there is no reinforcement. Second one is nano composite means nano particles are there. Only this ILSS is valid only for the fiber reinforced composite. So here also calculated for the only fiber reinforced hybrid composite. Here the value is 56 MPa in the longitudinal orientation, and similarly, just approximately 5 MPa in the transverse orientation. This is for the same reason what I explained for the flexural strength values. And this is the same I shown in the graphically here. So next one is here. So let us come to the evaluation of fracture toughness of these materials. So here you can see the plane strain conditions where to satisfy. And according to the ASTM standard 5045, so we have to create the crack. The crack that is here, you can see the second criteria, second validity condition, A by W is there. A is the crack length, W is the width of the sample. So always the A by crack length to width of the sample, that must be in between the 0.45 to 0.55. And this is A, W minus A, B must be greater than or equal to 2.5 KQ by W, KQ by sigma whole square. All these conditions must be satisfied. So then only the KQ becomes K1C. In other words, the conditional fracture toughness becomes plane strain fracture toughness. That is a valid fracture toughness. So here, I've taken one photograph of my sample here. I've introduced the crack. So specimen in the presence of notch. Crack is what I'm calling a notch here. So this have introduced maybe a dimer wafer blade, so which is having 150 microns thickness. You can see here. Now, before going to the fracture toughness test, suppose if I use blade with 150 microns, somebody is using razor blade, somebody using some hexa, somebody using more thickness blade. So that is not the case. That means, so we have to introduce the crack with a minimum notch radius. So for that, I did some experimentation here. The very first time I published this particular work in the international reputed journals. So you can go through my in internet, and I have used here. So thickness of isomet blade, I have used 150 microns, 150, 300, like that. So if I use 150 microns blade, I got 110 as the notch root radius. Please clearly observe this. So second 150 microns, so I got the notch root radius is 203. Just the notch root radius are measured by using profilometer, and if I used 150 microns blade, notch root radius is 110. Finally, I got value fracture toughness is 1.673. So you can see here. So these six values up to 1.6698. So there up to 1.698. So there is no much variation of the fracture toughness value. So after that, the fracture toughness is increases gradually. That means, so the fracture tough, we can calculate one has to find out the fracture toughness of this material means, so that this notch radius must be less than the 340. Similarly, you can take for nano composite up to 297 notch radius, the fracture toughness is 1.59959. After that, the fracture toughness is increasing gradually. That means one has to find out the fracture toughness of nano composite means always the notch radius must be less than 297. That is, so fracture toughness is independent below 297 microns. So similarly, in the case of the neat epoxy, fracture toughness is independent. So below 350, 340 microns, this is very clearly shown in the next one. You can see here. So this is some 290 here, 247, the previous one. After this, the fracture toughness is gradually increasing. Here also fracture toughness gradually increases. That means, so very carefully, what is the conclusion of this one is, very carefully we have to introduce the notch. The notch radius must be, we have to maintain a critical value that must be less than the critical value. This value is called critical value in this case. So this value is called critical value in this case. So we should not we should not introduce the notch so greater than the critical notch radius. Right. Similarly, for hybrid composite also, I did the same testing. So here you can see critical notch radius in the case of longitudinal orientation is 270 microns. What is the meaning of 270 microns? 270 microns means one has to find out the fracture toughness of this material means always we have to create the notch that must be less than 270 microns. So here also in the case of transverse orientation, the notch radius must be less than the 390 microns. So these are the load versus displacement graphs. So drawn directly got from the Instron here, UTM. So with different A by W ratios, right? So all the values are summarized in this particular tabular form. You can see here KQ values are given. KQ is nothing but conditional fracture toughness values. Here one value is 0.970, 0.666, 0.654, 1.654, 1. Here 1.579 and 1.853 only valued values. So because if you see the A by W values here, you can see 0.50 is there, 0.55 is there. As per the ASTM standards, if A by W ratio is in between 0.545 to 0.55, those are called as K1C values are valid K1C value. That is plane strain condition satisfied. That is the reason here star mark is there. Here also some star mark is there for nano composite. Similarly, these are the load versus displacement plots. So for calculating the fracture toughness of hybrid composite, in the hybrid composite, I got the value 23.12 MPa root meter. So in the previous case, 1.7 for the nano neat epoxy and 2.7 for nano composite. Here I got the 23.12. So there is significant variation of the fracture toughness, significant increase of fracture toughness value in case of the hybrid composite as compared to the previous composite. That means, so there is significant contribution of carbon fibers in the case of the hybrid composites. So whereas in the case of the transverse orientation, I got only 0.94, which is very much lesser than the even neat epoxy. So that means the carbon fibers plays a major role in the case of the hybrid composite. Here as I shown very clearly here values, neat epoxy I got 1.702 MPa root meter. The fracture toughness units are MPa root meter. And in the case of nano composite, 2.02 MPa root meter. In the case of the hybrid composite in the longitudinal orientation, I got the value 23.12. The significant increase in the value, so because of the carbon fibers. And this is the R curve behavior, that is the total fracture energy released here. So we can see from this graph, so neat nano composite is having high total fracture energy release rate as compared to the neat epoxy here. So the same curves I've drawn for the hybrid composite also. Now, so here the conclusion from the previous previous values is that the fracture toughness values gradually increased from neat epoxy to nano composite to hybrid composite. So finally, in the hybrid composite, the carbon fibers that plays a major role to increase the fracture toughness values or interlamellar strength values or in the flexure strength values. Now we have to justify those answers. So by using fractography, that is nothing but same micrographs. Here you can see the same micrograph for neat epoxy. The same micrograph for neat epoxy, which shows very glassy appearance. Nothing is visible on the screen. So the glassy appearance means there is no resistance to propagation of the crack. That is the reason here. So perfectly glassy appearance in the case of neat epoxy. That means there is no question. There is no reinforcement in this particular neat epoxy. That is the reason here. Glassy appearance here. Second one you can see here. Right. So these are the fracture graphs, the fracture surface of nano composite here. So we can see some rough surface. So this clearly indicates, so there is some resistance to propagation of the crack. So that is the reason here. So we got higher values even in the case of all the values, that is interlamellar shear strength, flexural strength, and factor toughness values in the case of nanocomposite. Here, that means because of this rough surface, it requires more energy or more fracture energy to failure of this specimen. Next. So this is the FEGSEM, that is the field emission gun micro SEM images of nanocomposite. These are beautiful pictures. I got this from IIT Mumbai. You can see this here. CNTs, that is amino multi-wall carbon nanotubes pull out. So always that pull out increases the fracture energy. So apart from the pull out, so we can see here initially I have taken 20 to 30 nanometer size of this carbon nanotubes. So here if I measure this size, so this is more than this 30, around 50 nanometers. So that means, so there is a good bonding between the epoxy material and carbon nanotubes. So that is the one more reason to increase the strength of this particular hybrid composite. So here you can see the second one. So here step-like morphology. So each step indicates a different cleavage mechanism. So that means here it requires more fracture energy. That is the reason fracture resistance of these hybrid composites increases enormously as compared to the nanocomposite and neat epoxy. Second one is, you can see here. So in between the carbon filaments, so here mixed with epoxy and CNT epoxy matrix surface here. So this is the encircled magnified view is shown in the figure B. Here there's a homogeneous distribution, and also we can see pull out of the CNTs here. And next we can see here. So same diagram here, same micrographic fracture surface hybrid composite. So we can see here CNTs, so uniformly distributed. This uniform distribution is possible because I have taken here amino multi-walled carbon, some functionalized carbon nanotubes. If I didn't take functionalized mark, what is going to happen means, so these all carbon nanotubes are going to settle at one place. So there is no question of homogeneous distribution here. So this we have to check very carefully. And next one is here, you can see here. I told you in the beginning. So this is the graph for the longitudinal orientation here. You can see here the fibers are in this direction, that is along the length direction. Here the crack. Hello.
Sir, the graph is not shown, sir.
It is moving automatically. Right.
Okay, sir.
See in the longitudinal direction, so the crack propagation is perpendicular to the orientation of the fibers. You can see here, so these fibers are longitudinal, but the crack propagation is perpendicular to this. So that is the reason here in the longitudinal orientation, so we got very higher values as compared to the transverse orientation. So here you can see the bent and broken fibers in the case of the fracture surface. Now you can see in the transverse orientation here, so the crack propagation is along the length of the fibers. So that is the major difference. That means there is no resistance to propagation of the crack in case of the transverse orientation. So next, so same graph here. Right. Now I'm coming to the summary of this particular presentation. So here, composite characterization is a field that is evolving quite rapidly and majorly. So we have to focus on the fracture toughness parameters. So because the strength values are also higher for the composites. It's automatically moving. Right. The major problem with the composites is low fracture toughness values. To increase the fracture toughness values, the composite characterization is a field that is evolving quite rapidly. Composites are many outstanding property enhancements which pave the newer materials and material design philosophies. In the present talk, I have illustrated such a design philosophy based on the long and continuous fiber reinforced hybrid composites. This talk emphasizes Stock emphasizes the need for the further development in India and over all our evaluation of continuous fiber composite technologies at a global level. So here, so in this presentation, I use the continuous fibers, carbon fibers, and CNT fibers. So this is about the my presentation. So now the forum is open for the participants. If any question, you can ask through organizer.
Sir, I think no attendees put it in the chat box. Any question?
Okay.
Okay, sir. I thank Dr. K. Chandrasekhar, sir. He explained in detail in a very informative session about the composites and classifications and mechanical properties like fracture toughness, flexural properties, fracture resistance. When both are hybrid and nano composites. I thank once again for all participants to for the fourth day in session. I thank our management and mechanical department, staffs, HODs and deans. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thanks to all participants for patient listening. So thank you for giving opportunity. Thank you for EGS Pillai Engineering College team. So especially thanks to Chuppalingam Singarvel, sir. Thank you, sir. Right, sir.
Thanks.